Mansize Radio.
For men.
All right, mate.
The wise man with an answer for everything is brought to you in part by Dronenberg Custom Lawnmowers. Paradise by the grass box lights. Click stripybitinthemiddle.com. He's watched the sunrise over Machu Picchu. He's close personal friends with Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's been invited for drinks at number 10. He's a fully qualified financial advisor, GP, and quantity surveyor, philosopher, and holistic therapist. Some people call him the patron saint of radio, but you can call him the wise man with an answer for everything. Challenge the wise man now on Mansize Radio for men. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio.
The wise man with an answer for everything.
You're listening to The Wise Man, with an answer for everything. Welcome to my radio broadcast. It's the programme which was recently described in International Logic magazine as being, quote, almost as complex as a Large Hadron Collider, unquote. Now, since we last spoke, it's been a week of mixed fortunes for the wise man. Firstly, now that the embargo has been lifted, I can now proudly and happily announce that I am the first ever human being to be classified with a British Standard Kite Mark, the hallmark, I think you'll agree, of excellence. On a slightly more non-logical note, I also managed to reverse my wife's Corsa into a builder's van which was parked inconsiderately, if not illegally, at the bottom of our drive. She wasn't very happy. So stay tuned for the usual mind-melding entertainment, including, time permitting, another edition of 60-second Supernovas, our big prize-winning musical collection game. Plus, of course, I'll be attempting, successfully, to answer all your questions in a compelling and easily digestible way. Plus, possibly, a bit of Val Dunican. And don't forget, you can contact the show at any time by sending a email to thewiseman@mansizeradio.com. That's thewiseman@mansizeradio.com. The wise man, one word. Not the wise man, one word, at mansizeradio.com. The wise man is one word for the purposes of an email address. All the world is a radio station, and all the men and women are merely listeners, awaiting an answer from the wise man, with an answer for everything, on Mansize Radio for Men. Now let's find out, how can I help you?
Mansize Radio.
I am the wise man, and this is Mansize Radio for Men, and I am here on this occasion not to answer a question, but to apprise you of a new policy which my own think tank have been working on for some weeks. And it is with a view to not only making a contribution to the righting of our economic woes, that's righting, R-I-G-H-T-I-N-G, of course, but also to going some way towards alleviating the difficulties, the pain, the heartache which so many young people face in this day and age on leaving school, knowing that they simply don't have the credentials to acquire anything better than, and even then they're lucky to acquire, a muck job, flipping burgers. And it's this. When many of our youngsters leave school, they may have no prospect of a job, but at least they have a couple of certificates, some GCSEs, even low grade, make a massive contribution towards a young person's sense of achievement. It gives them closure on their academic time, and they never know whether they might be asked to produce those qualifications as they attend an interview for that elusive job. However, there are a great many youngsters who leave school who have nothing. No qualifications at all. Not a single piece of paper. And it's of them that I'm thinking, as myself and my think tank proceeded to prowl around a number of initiatives which would not only give some self-respect to such youngsters, but would also give them a step up in the world, help them at least get onto the first step of the ladder of self-esteem, self-worth, and employability. So we suggest that each youngster who leaves school with no qualifications whatsoever receives, at the end of school assembly, not a certificate, but a ferret. A live, young ferret to take home and show whichever members of their extended family they find themselves living with at that point in their lives. Now, what would be the benefits of providing the young with a ferret on leaving school with no qualifications? Well, a ferret will require care and attention. And these youngsters may well be dissuaded from starting a family too young if they discover in looking after their young ferret just how difficult it is to maintain a young, vulnerable, dependent in this day and age on benefit. Indeed, there were those members of the think tank who suggested that youngsters should not have access to any form of benefit payments until they have cared for their ferret for a period of perhaps 12 months, showing a certain diligence, work ethic, intuition, intellectual application in creating a successful home for the ferret, caring for the ferret, feeding the ferret, exercising the ferret, possibly getting it to do one or two tricks. A ferret will encourage youngsters to make contact with different generations within their family. A youngster will have to go to granddad on the first day home with the ferret to ask what the fuck it is. Disputes between fat boys could be settled, if they're too obese to have a fight, by ferret fighting. And indeed, opportunities for entrepreneurial activities involving the free ferret abound, ranging from ferret fighting in a pub back room through to ferret shows and, of course, ferret breeding. So although the idea is only just past the prototype stage, we feel that it is ready for a wider discussion. I am the wise man, and this is Mansize Radio for men and small rodents. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio.
Mansize Radio for Men, I'm the wise man. Eddie Furrow of Blantyre asks, how can I prove my next door neighbour works for Al-Qaeda? Well, being pedantic, Eddie, nobody works for Al-Qaeda. Or do they? Who does their filing? Who is on reception to make sure that nobody wanders in? Who is checking all the job applicants to make sure they've got NVQ level 5 in jihad? Who goes round the car park checking that all the goats have got the correct permits? I put it to you, Eddie, that perhaps your neighbour is an Al-Qaeda Jobsworth. In which case, what you have to do is rent yourself a Navy SEAL uniform from your local fancy dress hire and stand underneath his bedroom window making helicopter noises. I think you'll find, Eddie, that answers your question. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
Is Elvis alive and running a head shop in Great Yarmouth? Thank you very much. Only the wise man.
I'm the wise man with an answer for everything. You're listening to the radio station for men with wan smiles and old copies of Lookin magazine in the loft. It's Mansize Radio for Men in Peril.
Was the Titanic a giant alien ark deliberately sunk by the Welsh government? Only the wise man knows.
I am the wise man, and you are the ref. 5 minutes into the second half, you realise that one side has too many players. You stop the game and confirm that the away team has fielded 12 men, 3 women, a capuchin monkey, and a parachutist. Do you A, order the extra players off and continue the game with 40 minutes left of the match? B, book the extra players and restart the half? C, abandon the match and book the parachutist for descent? You're listening to Mansize Radio. I am the wise man. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio.
I am the wise man with an answer for everything on Mansize Radio for Men. And Sean of the Bed emails, wise man, why haven't I had a cold for at least 4 winters? Fine question, Sean. Some of us are able to go without a cold for 10 or 20 years. And my own theory on this used to be that those of us who were very, very busy were simply too busy to have a cold. Sometimes you would wake up on Christmas morning and just have to go back to bed because you're that rough, because your body finally relaxes and gives it permission to be ill. Or you go on holiday, looking forward to it for months. You get there on the Saturday, on the Sunday, you're in bed, being ill, because your body's been given permission to be ill, because you're not working hard anymore. But that theory is currently being challenged by a new one that I've developed. I'm researching it in my conservatory before I unveil it on the world. Not that I expect Harley Street or the British Medical Association or the world of doctors to take any notice, no matter how compelling the evidence, because they're thick-skulled. Are medical people very thick-skulled, and their favourite expression is, there is no evidence for that. Well, at the moment, I don't have any hard evidence for that, I agree, but I'm working on it. And the theory is this. You know, they say that if you catch a cold, unlike other illnesses, it doesn't make you immune to catching a cold. All right, okay, we all accept that. You know, once you get mumps, you're not going to get them again. Once you get chicken pox, you're not going to get them again. That's what immunisation is based on. It would appear, though, that the cold germ just keeps striking. Ah, but does it? Does it? Perhaps it's possible that there are only about 50 different strains of cold germ, and they're all separate. And once you've had cold A1, let's say cold A1, you can never have cold A1 again. But what happens is, 9 months after you've had cold A1, cold B1 comes round. And of course you can have that because you've never had it before. And then cold C1 and D1. And all the way through until you've had 50 different types of cold. And here's the key insight. Every cold is slightly different. Some of them deliver a seriously streamy nose and lots of mucus. Others are achy joints and a sore throat, but not quite flu. It's a cold, but it's different from the cold you had before. Of course it's different from the cold you had before. We're stupid enough, hello doctors, to call every cold a cold. What they should be doing is, as with hurricanes, giving each cold strain as it comes along its own individual name. It should be called cold Agatha, cold Bertha, cold Clara, whatever. And then once we've got all the colds and had all the colds, there's only one or two colds that we haven't had, and it's going to take 4 or 5 or 10 or 15 years before that particular strain shows up, and then you've got it.
As I say, I'm researching this one in my conservatory. I am the wise man.
Hi.
On Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
Sally called when she got the word. She said, I suppose you've heard about Alice. I don't know why she's leaving or where she's gonna go. I guess she's got her reasons, but I just don't wanna know. 'Cause for 24 years I've been living next door to Alice.
Alice! Who the f*** is Alice?
Mansize Radio.
Mansize Radio for Men, and I am the wise man who can't find his emails. Ah, there they are. Let's have a look. Selko Dijing from Africa asks, wise man, is Canada British or American? Can you tell me more about Canada? Well, Selko, assuming you're not Nigerian, Canada was set up in 2003 by President George W. Bush to act as a buffer zone between Sarah Palin and Washington. When that failed, it was downgraded in status as a nation to a Category 4, putting it on a par with icebergs and extinct volcanoes. And whales, obviously. No Canadians are allowed to live further north of the American border than 75 feet, except for Bear Grylls and Ray Mears, who've been given a special visa to go up into the mountains for Channel 5 and see which of them can be the first to eat each other. Selko, I think you'll find that answers your question. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
All right.
You're listening to The Wise Man with an answer for everything on the radio station with a sink full of dirty dishes and a hole punched in the kitchen door. It's Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
The Wise Man with an answer for everything. He's proudly supported by Badger's Paw Real Ales, the original farmyard taste of hops, hay, and dead mice.
Beep, beep!
How do those training shoes get onto the central reservation of motorways? Only the wise man knows.
Mansize Radio.
Wise man here on Mansize Radio for Men with an answer for everything. And this from John, who says, dear wise man, excuse me, 2 nights ago I dreamt that I was in a harem and was serviced, to my great satisfaction, by ladies of various ethnic persuasions. Last night, I was being tortured by 6 of my ex-girlfriends with various devices. My question is, why does our brain have it in for us during sleep? Surely it should be on our side. Best regards, John. It's a good question, John, and of course it's confounded everybody who's ever had a think about last night's dream. Which, yeah, I guess is every single human being who's ever lived, and one or two dogs, if you ever have seen them lying on the hearth going with their eyes closed. Nobody really knows or gets it at all. It's crazy. The only reason we go to sleep, of course, is because the planet is dark for approximately half the amount of time in a day, and there's not much you could do when we were evolving, when it was dark, because only a few species have night vision or whatever. So some kind of energy-saving hibernation lasting 8 to 12 hours necessary. Why the brain doesn't go to sleep is probably the same answer as why the heart doesn't go to sleep. Because if the heart went to sleep, then obviously we'd be in trouble. Unless we'd evolved some kind of way of not needing the blood to circulate, so on and so forth. So a little bit of brain activity is going to happen. How does it work to our benefit? Well, the best I can come up with, John, and this one is a teaser, and I'm the only person I know who's actually read Freud's book on dreams, which is book 4. Everybody's got views on Freud except me, and I'm the only person who's read him. Everybody thinks that Freud has been proved to be wrong. That's what they say. Even eminent psychologists I read a book the other day which just started by saying, two people who were in practice, practicing psychology on disturbed children, they'd written a book, and they just start by saying casually, of course, we now know that Freud was wrong. Ha! You know, I bet they haven't read his book. And once you read his book, you realise that you aren't sure, really, whether he was right or wrong. But you know what he said? He said that basically every dream activity is connected with sex. And he doesn't have a great deal to go on to prove that, except that most men are in some sort of a state of arousal during most dream activities, however benign or neutral or asexual, basically, their dream is. Anyway, I have this, and this is the best I've got, and it's my own. John, if our dreams were better than our waking lives, we'd be miserable. We'd wake up every morning and go, oh, God, I really don't want to get up. I want to go back to that dream. Whereas, John, you have to admit, the 99 times out of 100, you wake up and go, oh, what a terrible dream. That was Basil, wasn't it? Do you remember? Oh, what a terrible dream. Which episode was that? Basil. Oh, what a terrible dream. Was it the one with Mrs. Penoir? I can't remember. Anyway, that isn't the point. The point is that because our dreams are awful, we're almost relieved that it's 6:15 and we've got to get up in a minute and get dressed and go off and do something we don't want to do, i.e. live our real life. So bad dreams, disturbing dreams, annoying dreams, dreams where our brain appears to have it in for us, whether it's the brain's intention or not, actually help us realise that our lives aren't so bad, aren't as bad as they probably actually are. John, I think you'll find that answers your question. I am indeed the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate?
Mansize Radio.
Mansize Radio for Men, and I am the wise man. And Mark Gale of Basingstoke asks, why are doctors' receptionists such snooty cows? Mark, it sounds to me as though you may suffer from a little low self-esteem, but bear in mind, they do too, big time. Like all underachievers, or losers as they're technically called, give them a little bit of power, you know, like security guards, minicab drivers. But what can you do? Well, you can try, when they say, what's the problem, reply, I don't know, I'm not a doctor. Are you? Oh no, of course you're not. Or you could make a block booking to see the doctor every Monday at 8:30 for the next 2 years. Then all you have to do is call on a Monday morning and cancel. And if you're feeling a bit queasy or you fancy 4 days off work, just turn up. Or you could try some sort of comedy threats along the lines of, what seems to be the problem? I think it's a mental health issue. I seem to be carrying out despicable acts against people who are obstructive to me on the phone. I think you'll find, Mark, that answers your question. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio.
You're listening to the man they would call the wise man if they knew. It's Mansize Radio for Men. The wise man, by the way, with an answer for everything. Here comes an email from John who says, dear wise man, amongst my family and friends, I am thought of as a comedian and bon vivant. But I have had first-hand experience of German humour, Dutch slapstick and American droll stand-up. I'm afraid, for the most part, none of this even eked a smile from my very British countenance. Is it them or me? I suspect them, as our jocular nature is multifarious and rich like our contemporary music since the 1960s. Compare, John says, for instance, the eclectic and grandiloquent Electric Light Orchestra with the monotone and prescriptive Übergroup Kraftwerk. However, just by illuminating this more minor difference in character and hinting at further superiority in scientific, military and social endeavours, in brackets, as our empire would attest, he closes brackets, let me proffer the essential question, does this make us better than the Krauts, Yanks and clog wearers? Well, John, thanks very much indeed for a long and thoughtful question. It can be evidenced, a yay or a nay, we are better or we are not better, in so many different ways, drawing on so many different aspects of the human condition. But let's confine ourselves, shall we? At your unconscious suggestion, confine ourselves to the microscopic examples that you proffer, namely Electric Light Orchestra versus Kraftwerk. I'm not an expert on either, although I did once go to Wembley and found myself seeing the Electric Light Orchestra, which I think went something like this. Mr. Blue Sky. Now, my only experience of Kraftwerk, or Kraftwerk, as I pronounced it earlier, just trying to make out I knew who they were, and I vaguely do, because they've sort of come round again a little bit, slightly, which is worrying, is of a song, and I'm not even sure if it's theirs, but it goes something along the lines of fun, fun, fun on the Autobahn, fun, fun, fun on the Autobahn. Now, that may not be Kraftwerk, or Werk, even, but whether it is or isn't, it probably illustrates what they were about, as well as anything, whether they did it or not. And as for Mr. Blue Sky, that definitely was the Electric Light Orchestra. So what we can do is condense the question, are we better than the Krauts, the Yanks and the clog wearers, into what is better, Mr. Blue Sky, or Fahn, Fahn, Fahn on the Autobahn. And I go with Fahn, Fahn, Fahn on the Autobahn because it is actually beautifully weird in a sort of a Doctor Who way. You can see the creatures from Kraftwerk coming down the corridor towards the Doctor and his sidekick, who is shrieking, "Run, Doctor." Whereas with the Electric Light Orchestra, they're just another band, reasonably competent in a sort of a session musician, fat, ugly, beardy way. Whereas Kraftwerk put something together, poor though it was, fun, fun, fun on the Autobahn, is beautifully bonkers. Mr. Blue Sky is extremely annoying. So, since, John, you chose Electric Light Orchestra versus Kraftwerk, or Werk, I'm going that the Krauts, the Yanks and the clog wearers are better than us. Do email me if you say different. Sorry, I'm alone in the building and I just heard something creak. You see, you mentioned Doctor Who and before you know where you are, you're in the middle of your own episode, aren't you? Where there's something in the attic. Not cash, by the way. It's a little bit early, that's on in about half an hour, isn't it? I am the wise man with an answer for everything, and this is Mansize Radio for men. All right, mate.
Does Peter Andre dream in colour? Only the wise man knows.
I'm the wise man with an answer for everything. Don't forget, coming up later on Mansize Radio, it's the fellow with the noddy holder hat and the Jimi Hendrix handshake. Of course, it's Steve God's Rock Apocalypse, the best place to hear solid rock and raw grit talk for real men.
And Steve God is without doubt the best connected radio presenter in rock. When Keith Richards climbed that palm tree, the coconut milk was for Steve God's pina colada. When Graham Parsons collapsed that time, it was an ice cube from Steve God's freezer that brought him back. The Rock Apocalypse features all the usual stuff, including Heartbreak Hotel, the sad, sad splitting up feature for Men Too Tough to Cry, plus songs you absolutely have to play a guitar to, and of course, the best music in the rock universe and beyond. Don't miss Steve God's Rock Apocalypse, coming up later here on the Manly Entertainment Network, we call Mansize Radio. All right, mate. Now listen up and grab an earful of these Fabergé eggs of audio advertising.
The wise man with an answer for everything is supported in part by Chickfield Dolphin Language School. Speak fluent dolphin in as little as 6 weeks. Click. .com. Your bell is broken. Mansize Radio. The wise man with an answer for everything.
I am the wise man with an answer for everything. Welcome along to another program hosted by me, the wise man with an answer for everything. Men with evil manners live in brass, their virtues we write in water. The wise man has been busily occupied since we last spoke. Firstly, I wrote a paper on structural steel design, which has been forwarded to the American Society of Metallurgy for reference purposes, which was very exciting. Also, on the insistence of Mrs. Wise Man, I was forced to clear out the cupboard from beneath the stairs, which was a bit of a chore. So if anyone would like to inherit a collection of years and years and years worth of New Scientist magazines, please contact the show. You'll need a van and probably live somewhere near the South Coast area. And don't forget, contacting the show is as logically straightforward as sending a email to thewiseman@mansizeradio.com. So once more, down the primrose path of knowledge, I am the wise man with an answer for everything on Mansize Radio for Men. My radio surgery is now open, so let's find out how I can help you. Promised you a miracle.
I spoke in days break wondering. Mansize Radio.
You are listening to Mansize Radio for Men, and I am the wise man with an answer for everything. I have this from Hillman Imp 147. Wise man, my agent tells me that I have ASD. But is a bit vague about exactly what ASD is. Well, Hillman Imp, I'm glad you came to the wise man. We psychiatrists recognize ASD as now affecting up to 9 out of every 9 people in the United Kingdom. It stands for attention seeking disorder. And experts are concerned that ASD, attention seeking disorder, is enjoying a marked increase amongst the population since the turn of the century. Their concern is so great that they have contacted the media, television, radio, set up some websites, set up a number of blogs, made themselves available for interview on TV and by newspapers, photograph included, and magazines. Some experts are even prepared to cold call people and tell them how much they know about ASD and a little bit about themselves, their hobbies, their likes, their dislikes, and why they're generally misunderstood and not appreciated either at work or at home. Experts say that their reaction to this increase in ASD is in itself proof that ASD is very much on the rise. But is it a bad thing? Well, you say, Hillman Imp, that it is your agent who tells you that you have ASD, attention seeking disorder, which leads me to think that you are referring either to your theatrical or show business agent, in which case surely ASD is of enormous value. How can anybody who wants to perform not be seeking attention?
Or perhaps you're talking about your letting agent, which would be an entirely different matter. I think you'll find, Hilmanimp, that answers your question. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
Good day to you. I am the wise man, and this is Mansize Radio for Men. Wisdom. It was, I believe, the great Japanese sage and samurai Yamamoto Jinmon who said in that seminal collection of samurai wisdom, Hagakure, meaning fallen leaves, that until the age of 40, a man should dedicate his life to vitality. And don't get me wrong, I'm still vital. I still hope to turn out one last time in an emergency for Tewkesbury, Brunswick, on a Sunday morning in the Somerset Southwest Division 4, in my time-honoured role of midfield dynamo. No blade of grass left untouched. And if you doubt my vitality, you can ask Christine Jones. Back then, I was vital, or at least trying to be. Now, Jinmon goes on to say that around about one's 40th year, a man should begin to dedicate himself to wisdom. I have dedicated myself to wisdom for too long, perhaps. And yet, sometimes in a blinding flash, things I didn't know become clear to me. As we search for wisdom, we draw down the wisdom of the millennia. Buddhism, Confucianism, Taoism, Hinduism. Why, there's good stuff in the Talmud, the Quran, the Bible, Khalid Gibran, Krishnamurti. All of these people have something to say, and yet it seems to me to find wisdom is something that you must do yourself. So you should look beyond the wisdom that's been passed down the generations and seek it yourself. But where? On TV? On the radio? Maybe, occasionally, little pearls, little nuggets. In film, perhaps, but only the French ones. In music, perhaps. For maybe culture is the best way, by immersing ourselves in art and literature and music. Immersing ourselves, occasionally, a blinding truth will simply stand before us in the long straight road towards death. And this is what's happened to me. Because for many years, my interest in music didn't really extend beyond Tamla Motown. I'm a huge fan of the Temptations, the Royal Four Tops. I do believe that one of their hits, Still Waters Run Deep, was written by the future American president, Calvin Coolidge. But we'll come back to that. Music. I tried classical, as we all do, but no words. You know, Beethoven goes da 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 da, but it's not like he's saying I bought a dog and it died. So you have to work out yourself what it's all about, and you might have it wrong. So classical music, no, for me, not even opera. You know what I'm talking about. Pop, well, it's self-consciously superficial, isn't it? I mean, the whole depth and beauty of pop music is that there is no depth or beauty. It's here today, gone tomorrow, bubblegum music. What do they say? Bubblegum for the ears. And as for jazz, come on, it's crap. No. For years and years and years, I looked down my nose at a particular type of music. I'm standing in the kitchen of my sprawling residence just outside Tewkesbury, in case you wondered why the Atmos changes from time to time. I'm just turning to my new toy, which is an internet radio that enables me to listen to radio stations all around the world. And hence, I started listening to a type of music that I've always thought was the lowest of the low. But the more I listen to it, this isn't very representative. I've just tuned in God knows where. This is Kix Country.
Well, we'll get back to that when they start giving us some words so we know what we're talking about.
That's why we're taught. Life training this one like an old honky tonk. Greasy cheeseburgers and cheap cigarettes. One day they'll get me if they ain't got me yet. I've been living and fast forward.
You see, the thing about country and western music is, I mean, you know, it's just about the stuff of life. It's about the stuff of our lives. It's not just about dogs or your woman leaving you or your mum dying. You know, this guy's going on about cheeseburgers and packs of cigarettes. And you get songs about how to get wrestling tickets and probation and table dancers. There's a song out there about four pickup tires. I know it sounds like I'm just reciting on the country and western 12 days of Christmas, and I am, because I can't get it out of my head. Three shotgun shells, two hunting dogs, and some parts of a Mustang GT. It's brilliant, because it's not only deeply sentimental in a sort of Scouser way, you know, but it takes the mick out of itself. It knows what it's all about. And one last thing about country and western music, which is why it's fantastic, is this, quite simply. At the moment, hang on. Oh, he's going on. I'll just leave him to it. This is the thing. Since the death of Elvis and Sinatra and then Michael Jackson, surely the greatest entertainer on earth at the moment is Dolly Parton. Really? You think about it. I mean, what a performance. What a star quality. What looks, what physique, what a voice. And the way she gets those songs across, whether you think she means it or whether you think she's taking the mickey, it's an absolutely unbelievable performance. She's a hugely successful businesswoman. And didn't she get an Oscar, or nominated at least, for that film 9 to 5, where she was one of the secretaries along with Jane Fonda? So there you have it. I strongly recommend, in your quest for wisdom and why else are we here, that you give more than just a fleeting sneer in the direction of country and western. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
Well, it's up for Wednesday.
Terry.
Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
All right.
I'm the wise man with an answer for everything. Don't forget, coming up later today, it's Hit the Floor and Gimme 50 with ex-Special Forces Sergeant Tom Gollock. He's the man so tough he once sneezed and a bullet came out. He once got a stone in his shoe and the stone surrendered. His favourite hobbies are driving tanks over insurgents and playing the best music for men this side of the Mekong Delta. He's been to hell and back, and he's got a sticker on the back of his armoured pursuit vehicle to prove it. So, fall in and stand to attention, and don't miss ex-Special Forces Sergeant Tom Gollock coming up throughout the day on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate?
The wise man with an answer for everything. He's proudly supported by Badger's Paw Real Ales, the original farmyard taste of hops, hay, and dead mice.
The wise man knows, because he just knows. You get me, gangster. Challenge the wise man with an answer for everything now.
Mansize Radio.
You're listening to the wise man with an answer for everything, with another word to the wise. Don't ever take a fence down unless you know the reason it was put up. Alan Titchmarsh told me that once when I worked with him on the set of Crossroads. He was playing Benny's assistant. Won a BAFTA for it, I think. You're listening to Mansize Radio for Men in Peril. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio.
This is Mansize Radio, and I am the wise man with an answer for everything. You can email your question to thewiseman@mansizeradio.com. I have an anonymous email. I suspect it comes from a male, but he, possibly she, has asked me not only to maintain their anonymity, but also to paraphrase their question, which is something like this. Dear wise man, I often meet girls who say they regret that they were sent to convent school when they were young. I, in contrast, would have loved to have gone to a convent school. Well, anonymous, assuming you're a male, but even if you are a female, I think I detect the angle that you're coming from here. And I'd like to move the conversation to a slightly higher plane, because I would have liked to have attended a convent school. But primarily, if not only, because I would have liked the option of becoming a nun, an option that was denied to me. And as the wise man, I am often reminding people that nothing makes us happier than options. This fact alone is a reason why it's a good idea to often do nothing. Because when inert, we are not making decisions. When we have made decisions, we have chosen a course of action, which means that our options are no longer available to us. So it is via this circuitous route, Anonymous, that I have transformed a mundane question, drenched in testosterone, into one which Confucius would have been proud to have been asked, and even prouder to have matched my answer. I am indeed the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
On a warm summer's evening, on a train bound for nowhere.
Mansize Radio.
Good day to you. I am the wise man, and you're tuned to Mansize Radio. And this, from Best Man Again DVD, asks Wise Man, what's best, constipation or diarrhea? Well, Best Man Again DVD, you know what? I'll be quite honest. This is one of the easiest questions I have ever been asked. And I'm going to give you, listening, half a second to see whether you and I are on the same hymn sheet. Ready? Go on then. In your head, or shout out loud, especially if you're in a train compartment. What is best, constipation or diarrhea? Go. Yeah, it's obvious, isn't it? Diarrhea. Easily better than constipation. Constipation's miserable. You're getting bunged up with stuff that shouldn't be inside your body. And for 2-3 days, however long you're constipated, you are deprived of one of man's greatest pleasures, which is sitting on the toilet. It just is. Obviously, making love is the greatest thing. Enjoying a banquet, whether it's, you know, half a dozen oysters and roast goose or fish and chips with brown sauce, eating is a huge pleasure. I would say that after that comes sitting on the toilet with a racing post, lock the door, the world can go away. I like to have the radio on when I'm in there for 15 minutes. Going to the toilet's marvellous. When you're constipated, you don't get it at all. When you've got diarrhea, you might get it 3 or 4 times a day. Diarrhea really is not all that bad, unless, of course, those unfortunate people who live in a part of the world where the drinking water is so, you know, bad that digestive disorders and diarrhea become a life-threatening thing. That is terrible, and I'm not talking about that here. I'm talking about the 2 or 3 days of trots everybody, young men in particular, get. And the diarrhea, in those circumstances, is not at all that bad. For start off, it's 2 days off work or college or school, isn't it? Because all you need to say is, I've got a tummy bug. Nobody wants to pick up your germs. You don't have to mention the 7 pints and the slightly dodgy kebab or whatever. Just don't mention it. Just say you've got a tummy bug and you can't come in because you're not able to stray far from the toilet. That's always the clincher. So 2 or 3 days off work, college or school, absolutely guaranteed with diarrhea. Diarrhea, it's not all that bad. You do get to sit on the can a lot, as discussed. And sitting on the can, even with the trots, is a great chance to relax. You can get to chapter 2 of Hitler's Greatest Panzer Divisions. You can do some thinking in private. Another reason why diarrhea is not all that bad is because which of us can't lose 2 to 4 pounds? Which, with a minor tummy disorder, you are very likely to do.
You do have to keep your strength up, though, because you're losing liquids and you're losing essential sugars and salts, which is why a steady supply of Lucozade and McCoy's Ridge Cut Salt and Vinegar Crisps is not just nice, it's essential. Having diarrhea is also, and this is a very difficult point, but I'm going to make it, it's socially expanding. It increases your 360-degree experience of being a human being. Because sitting on the loo, when you've got a loose tummy, is the closest you'll come to finding out what it's like to be a woman having a pee. Isn't it? You think, ah, that's the noise that they get whenever they have to do a number one. But also, it can be quite useful after you've been to the loo, if you have a loose tummy, to turn around before you flush and just have a look at the bowl, because the tide mark of what you have evacuated against the bowl will give you a perfect 360-degree contour map of your hemorrhoid situation. If, for example, you notice that the bowl's tide mark is much higher on the left of the bowl than on the right of the bowl, that will mean that you have some little grapes hanging that are pushing what is being evacuated in that direction. And it's, well, it's just a useful little top-up on your self-awareness of your own body. So, thank you for your contact. Best Man Again DVD. What is best, constipation or the trots? Answer, the trots, every time. I think you will find I have answered your question. I'm the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men in Peril. For what you want it to
be. I don't knows, but the wise man knows. Because the wise man knows what his nose knows, and you don't knows.
You're listening to the wise man with an answer for everything on the radio station for men who once camped outside the Bristol Old Vic in order to buy tickets for Roger Whittaker. And who weren't disappointed either. Particularly the impromptu whistle section of The Last Farewell. It's Mansize Radio for Men in Cardigans. All right, mate.
The wise man with an answer for everything is supported in part by Chitfield Dolphin Language School. Speak fluent dolphin in as little as 6 weeks. Click. .com.
Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
He-mail the wise man at mansizeradio.com. Tweet at mansizeradio. Hashtag wise man. Facebook.com/mansizeradio.
Mansize Radio for Men, today looking at how we can benefit from the clear identification of just who are the most important people on Earth. America's hillbillies. The ones who vote the Republicans into Senate and Congress and the White House all the time. Well, one thing that we could do is tell them that we are going to start introducing some of their fine concepts here in Great Britain. For example, we are lobbying the BMA to have hornswoggled recognised as a bona fide disease worthy of 4 days off work. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate. You're listening to The Wise Man on Mansize Radio for Men. And this from Coffee with Cream 96. Wise Man, is it true that Henry VIII wrote green sleeves? Well, Coffee with Cream, almost certainly he had something to do with it. He was known to be an accomplished musician. He was good on the lute. He played the mandola. And he often gave organ recitals at, no sniggering at the back, Henderson, thank you, organ recitals at the Abbey. Did he write green sleeves, though? Did he write green sleeves? No. Nobody wrote Glean Sleeves. It's just there now for anybody who wants to take that down off the shelf. Former limited company, only 90 quid. You know, you can do it online. But Green Sleeves, did he write Green Sleeves? He may have commissioned it. He may have offered one or two ideas, which, of course, the actual composer, the actual musicians would have been delighted to include in the final version of Greensleeves, because if you've got the King on your side as the co-writer, you know, Lennon, McCartney, Rodgers, Hammerstein, some bloke, Henry VIII, it's going to help. It's got to help. Did he actually write it, though? Probably in court, no. He did write something called The Madrigal's Delight. Everybody accepts that. It's a fairly standard piece compared to Greensleeves. He claimed to have written, I heard a maiden singing in the valley below. Here lie one morning, just as the sun was rising, I heard a maiden sing in the valley below. Oh, don't deceive me, oh, never leave me. How could you treat a poor maiden, so and so and so forth. A simple thing for a rich, proud voice. And of course, Henry VIII weighing in at 18 stone before his 30th birthday, most of it athletic muscle, he could certainly get down there with Pavarotti. So he wrote that one, or at least he in part wrote that one. Did he or did he not write, I'm leaning on the Catholic Church or else I'll start my own until a certain little lady gives me a son? Probably. We just don't know. That, of course, was picked up by the late, great vaudeville and film star George Formby, who made it into a classic, and indeed, for most of his career, it was his signature tune, retitled Stairway to Heaven. Did Stalin write Old Man River? Quite possibly. You can see it, can't you? Did Jeff Beck write the Gettysburg Address? Again, you just don't know. Was it Ringo Starr who composed most of Winston Churchill's famous wartime speeches? We'll just never know. Was it Benny out of ABBA who wrote the famous Martin Luther King speech? I have a dream. I have a dream. See what I'm saying? See how culture always manages to turn fully the circle of life. I am the wise man on Mansize Radio for Men. All right, mate.
Mansize Radio.
Mansize Radio for Men, the wise man with you, and Pigeon Fancier. Pigeon Fancier 007 emails. Wise man, I understand that you are a qualified doctor. I've had a dry scalp since I started secondary school and am now 34. Well, Pigeon Fancier, I'm not a qualified doctor as such. I am more of a specialist. And what we specialists say is that a dry, itchy scalp can be early signs of cancer. So, Pigeon Fancier, ask yourself these questions. Are you getting enough cranberry juice? Should you cut down on the number of vitamin supplements that you're taking? Should you avoid Germans? Drink your own urine. Wear a copper band instead of underpants. Continue for 1 mile and at the roundabout, take the third exit. Keep your old utility bills. Cut out dairy and glutamate. And drink 75 ounces of water for every 150 pounds you weigh. Get a dog. Floss. And try not to worry too much. It can cause stress, which can cause the phone to ring right in the middle of a really interesting broadcast. Who would be ringing the man-sized studio at this time of day? I'll find out. Enjoy a nice piece of music. I am the wise man on Man-Size, Dr. Wise Man on Man-Size Radio for Men. All right, mate.